Sometimes I feel the same. It takes your breath away. When will the morning break? I'll stay right by your side. Keep your hand in mine. I'll hold you through the night.
Small group. We're like Bible study group. I'm okay with that.
How's everybody doing?
Yeah? Good. I'm cool. We were just talking about the air conditioning doesn't work in my car. But there's air conditioning in here. So I am better than I was. Better than when I was really angry in my car in traffic. Well, let's go ahead and stand up and we'll pray together and we'll worship. Father God, Lord, I just thank you for our time together, God. Thank you for this place. Thank you for your body and that we get to come together and worship you, Lord. I just pray, God, that tonight our worship, though we be small, we are fierce. I pray that our worship would be glorifying to you, Lord, that we would come alongside the angels that sing day and night, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And that you would be honored by our worship tonight, Lord, that our hearts would be fixed on you, and that you would change us, Lord, through as we worship, through the worship that we offer to you, God. I pray that you would be transforming us, Lord. And we love you. We give you this time.
Commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else can make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises?
freedom that we have to worship you, Lord. Thank you that we get to come here and declare your praises. Pray that you bless us tonight, Lord, with your word, with your fellowship, God. Thank you for how powerful and beautiful and amazing you are, Jesus. Let's sing that one more time.
Take just a moment to greet one another and say hi to in a way that feels comfortable to you. You can grab some snacks and some coffee in the back. And if you haven't had a chance yet, you can meet Scott up here. Scott was playing acoustic for us, doing an awesome job. So you can meet him too. Good to be with you guys. Thank you so much for tuning in and hanging out with us. So a few quick announcements here. First one, everybody's favorite announcement, the toilets. And so it's time to do some potty talk, all right? We're going to talk about the toilets. And so I do apologize for this, but the toilets are out for one more week. And what happened was the problem that we ran into ended up being a little bit more severe than we were anticipating. And so we've had three companies out to look at it and scope and jet and plug and do everything, and it's still not quite done. And so we've got a company coming out Monday, and they're going to start some excavating. So we need to do some excavating in the front lawn and dig some stuff up, and so that will be done by next week, they have assured us. So by next week, we are good to go. And so until then, we have a lovely, clean, recently serviced porta potty right outside, right over there. And so you are free to use that as much as you would like. All right, potty talk over. Let's get down to the nitty gritty. So I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward, and we're going to take our offering. And so there's also a connect card in the back of your chair. If you haven't had a chance to fill one of those out yet, especially if you're new with us, you can do so. And that's just a way to let us know that you're here. And so we are excited to be able to do that. All right, well, you can give in a couple of different ways. They are listed up here for you. You can text to give. You can give online. You can drop it in the plate or mail in a check as well. Go ahead and bow your heads with me, and let's pray for the offering. God, we thank you for your provision to us. God, thank you that you are just the master of our provision. God, you are our shepherd. You are the one who leads us to green pastures. And so we praise you for that, and this offering comes out of that place, God. It is simply a way to say thank you for who you are and for everything that you've done in our lives. Amen. All right. Well, just a couple quick announcements here. And so if you turn your attention towards the screen, we have a really neat little QR code thing going on here, right there. And the way that works is we just recently redesigned sort of a welcome brochure, a brochure that talks about who we are. And there's one giant one up on the screen. There's also smaller ones around the building. If they were the same size, it would be really big. But what you do is, I can only show you on if you have an iPhone, but Android, I believe, works the same way. And so what you do is you just hold up your camera right to that QR code, and it will automatically catch it and scan it, and then you just press the link right there. And what that does is that takes you to this beautifully designed PDF. As soon as it loads, wait for it, there it is, bam. And so it takes you to this beautifully designed PDF, and it just talks about who we are. And what this is not just a statement of faith. This really outlines some distinctives about what makes us unique, what makes Radiant Church Radiant Church. And so we've listed just a small number of things, about half a dozen things there, that you can read through pretty quickly and just really neat. So you can save that to your phone, you can print it, you can do whatever, and we're going to have some printed copies of these as well. And we'll also be, if you're new and you've recently filled out a Connect card, we've had a ton of new families, and so we'll probably be emailing you one of those as well. Okay, well, that is it. Go ahead and turn your attention towards the screen, and we're going to watch a quick clip from a show, and then we'll dive into the Word of God together.
A little bit farther out.
I don't have a quarrel with you, teacher. But we've been doing this all night. Nothing. All right. That's your word.
Take that side! No! Ah!
love you. I love you. I love you.
The ball can still
get out. It can get out.
My brother and the baptizer. You are the Lamb of God, yes?
I am.
Depart from me. I am a sinful man. You don't know who I am and the things I've done.
Don't be afraid, Simon.
I'm sorry. We've waited for you for so long, we believe. But my faith, I'm sorry.
Lift up your head, fisherman.
What do you want from me? Anything you ask, I will do.
Follow me.
I will.
Rabbi.
You as well. Yes, you, James and John. Come, follow me.
Take the fish into market and settle up Simon's debt. I'll get some help to fill both of these boats.
Are you sure?
Yes, go.
What will you tell Ima?
You've just been called by the man we prayed for our entire lives. And you ask me, what will I say when you miss supper? Go, now.
All right, well, that was a short clip from a TV show called The Chosen. And really, really neat show. You can find it on a VidAngel, or they have their own app that you can actually download as well. It's something that Savannah and I have really enjoyed. We got kind of tired of the cheesy Christian shows and movies, and so this one is just a high production value and just a really cool depiction of Jesus. And so that's the story we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about the miraculous catch of fishes. And when Jeremy first asked me to preach on this passage, we're in our series on miracles of Jesus. We've spent a lot of time talking about the Proverbs, which is a real sort of nitty-gritty, boots-on-the-ground book, right? It really gets into your daily business, and so we just wanted to raise it up a little bit and just take a look at the person of Jesus and the miracles that he performed. But when he first told me, he said that I should call it the Great Hall of Fishes. That's what he wanted me to preach on, the Great Hall of Fishes. And so for some reason in my head, I pictured like a long hallway with a bunch of portraits of fishes in suits. And then he's like, no, Hall, H-A-U-L. I was like, oh, okay, that makes way more sense. I know where that is in the Bible. So anyways, it will be in Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Luke chapter 5, 1 through 11. And I'm going to read this for us this evening. Go ahead and stand with me, if you would, as we read the word of the Lord. On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake. But the fishermen had got out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they enclosed such a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. Take a seat and let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this this amazing story, Lord. Thank you that you are the God of miracles. Thank you that you are the master of the wind and the waves and the fish and everything else. And so I pray that as we dive into your word tonight, God, I pray that you would unearth things to us, unearth things that speak to our hearts, God, for encouragement, for conviction, for edification, for upbuilding, Lord. And that we would unearth what you have for us tonight in your son's name by the power of your spirit. Amen. All right. Well, as we jump in here to this text, just a little bit of context. This is right at sort of the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And so he's starting out, and this is shortly after, just a few paragraphs after, he showed up in the synagogue and read that passage from Isaiah. It talks about liberty from the captives and this amazing prophecy that's clearly talking about the Messiah. And then he lays it down, right? It would be like one of our scripture readers coming up and doing this, lays down the scroll at that time, rolls it back up, and he says, "Today, this has been fulfilled in your hearing." And so everybody is astonished. They are astonished by the authority that he speaks with and teaches with. And at this point, he's left the synagogue. He's out, and he is just down by the Sea of Galilee, which goes by a different name at this point only. It's the only place that shows up, the Sea of Gennesaret, just another name for Sea of Galilee. And so he was down there, and Simon is down there, and they've just come in from a whole night of trying to catch fish and catching absolutely nothing. Now, one thing to draw your attention to here is this is probably not the first time that Simon Peter, this is probably not the first time that he had seen Jesus. And so three things that we can look at here that tell us this. Number one, he calls him master right off the bat. He identifies him as master, so some degree of following up to this point. Number two, he leaves everything immediately and just goes and follows him. And so that certainly could have happened just because of the miracle, but it also could have happened because Jesus is calling him to a sort of new level of something that he had begun calling him to previously. And then thirdly, and probably most importantly, is John chapter 1, 40 and 42. And commentators say that this account happened before this miraculous catch of fish. So it says this, it says, "Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John the Baptist, had said, and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, 'We have found the Messiah, that is the Christ.' And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, 'You are Simon, son of John. You will be,'" in the future this is, "'called Cephas,'" which when translated is Peter." And so this is most likely the first time that Simon encountered Jesus. And now he performs this miracle and then calls him into basically vocational ministry. He calls him to full-time ministry, following Jesus around, being a disciple of Jesus, which was a not super uncommon thing back in the first century, where you would follow certain rabbis around and that would become your life. That would be your vocation. And so Jesus is calling him to make a radical shift from the life of a fisherman, which he has known all his life, to now the life of a student, the life of a disciple, the life of a learner. And so at this point, he's down by the Sea of Galilee. He's about to step into Simon's boat, and it says that the people were pressing in on him, right? And so the chosen, they only had like six people or something who were there to listen to him teach. It was probably more like hundreds. There could have been hundreds of people, maybe 1,000 people that were pressing in on him so much that it was just feeling like chaos. Have you ever had that in your home? If you have kids and you've had that in your home, it's like, I just need a boat and just push me out on the water a few feet and I'll just do a lot better, you know, unless your kids can swim. They're like, come here, come here. And so just chaos. And so he's saying, man, I gotta teach. I don't know if you've ever tried to do public speaking when there's a lot of distractions going on in the room. It's nuts. It's nuts. And so he climbs into Simon's boat and he says, press out a little bit from the shore. And so he goes out and it creates really a natural amphitheater, right? They didn't have PA systems. They didn't have megaphones. They didn't have iPhones they could text. They had none of it. They had the human voice. That was it. And so by pushing out on the water, it created a natural amphitheater and the sound bounced off the water. Savannah and I, we don't get to go to a lot of sit-down restaurants lately because we have our little three-month-old, and she doesn't like to sit with us or be happy. And so, anyways, we've been doing a lot of outside things. And so a couple times we've gone down to this place on the Vancouver waterfront called What a Catch. It used to be called the Daily Catch. And it's a little walk-up window connected to Wildfin, a restaurant down there. You get fish and chips, fish tacos. And then you can just sit outside, walk around, and eat it. And so we were just down there a couple days ago. And this boat was driving by. And this guy was like standing on it shirtless, you know. But anyways, they were driving by and they were listening to CCR, Creedence Clearwater Revival, right? It was good music. And what I was amazed by was it sounded like the music didn't sound that loud when they were right in front of us, but by the time they were what looked like 400 or 500 yards away, we could hear the music almost just as clearly as when they were right in front of us because it just bounced right off the water. And so that's what Jesus is doing. He's using this to create sort of a natural amphitheater so people can hear him. So to get a picture of the kind of fishing boat that Jesus was stepping into, go ahead and look on the screen here. This is something that they discovered in 1986, and this is what they call the Jesus boat. This was found at the bottom of the Sea of Galilee, and they were able to fill it, insulate it with foam, raise it to the surface, and it's now being stored in a climate-controlled room in a museum. And based on carbon 14 dating, the date on this boat is between 50 BC and 50 AD. And so this is right at the time when Jesus was doing his ministry. It would not have been a surprise for Peter to have at least seen this boat at some point when he was out there. He and his family were lifelong fishermen. And so a boat just like this, it obviously had more. This is decayed, right? It had walls and a mast and, you know, more stuff, but this is the base of the boat there. And so a boat just like this is what Jesus climbed into and pushed out from the land in. And then it says this. It says, he sat down and he taught the people from the boat. And earlier, remember it says they pressed in on him. But why did they press in on him? They didn't press in on him to see a miracle, they said. It said they pressed in on him to hear the word of God. And then the first thing he did was he sat down and he taught them from the boat. And so most of the time of this interaction, Jesus spends preaching. He is preaching to them the word of God. And so in the same way, that is why we are gathered here tonight. We are gathered here to preach the word of God. Preachers should preach the word of God. Listeners should hear the word of God. I am not up here to share with you my opinions. I am not up here to share with you the news or my commentary on the news. I'm not up here to tell you a bunch of fun stories. I am here to preach to you the word of God. That's what Jesus came to do, and that's what we seek to do every Saturday night and twice on Sunday. And so that's what we're here for. So I want to look at four things that we see in this passage, and not coincidentally. Oh, they all start with C, just like the word coincidentally. So first thing, the command. We're going to look at the catch, we'll look at the confession, and then we'll look at the call. Four C's. All right, first one, the command. It says, when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. And Simon answered, he said, Master, we've toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets. Now, Peter was a lifelong fisherman. All he knew was fish. He was probably one of the guys that had like the big mouth bass up on his wall. You remember those things? You know, like moved, and they have them at Goodwill now. I don't even think they make them anymore. Anyways, this guy lived for fish. That's what he lived for. His entire life was a fisherman. And this, in the first century, it didn't exist where somebody would kind of grow up and get to college age and then go try to find their career, right? Your career was whatever your dad's career was. That's it. Right? And so he was a fisherman. His dad was a fisherman. His brothers were fishermen. His grandfather was a fisherman. His uncle was a fisherman. His aunt was a fisherwoman. All that this guy knew was fish. And he had spent all night trying to catch something. And then all of a sudden, a carpenter comes up and tries to tell this fisherman how to fish. And so you can imagine how strange this would be. And they had already been out all night to try to find fish. And as any good fisherman knew, the night was the best time to fish. That's why they did it. They weren't just trying to like skirt under the radar or evade the authorities. That was the best time to find fish. By the time morning came, the fish were gone. There were no fish to be found. And secondly, the best place to find fish was not in the deep where Jesus tells them to go. The best place to find fish was in the shallows, right? They throw their net out, and then people might come even on the side standing and pull the net into the boat with the fish. So Jesus says, put out on the deep and throw your net over there in the middle of the day and see what happens. And so Peter naturally is very, very resistant to this. Nothing about this makes sense, but as we'll see in a little bit, he does it anyway. So when you have kids, you get used to one question that you hear very, very commonly. Do you know what that question is? Why? Or as I like to hear it, I don't like to hear it, as I often hear it, why? 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 You know, the other day, Wesley he's trying to learn the monkey bars. He's our 4-year-old, and Noah comes up and grabs him by the ankles and pulls him down off the monkey bars. And so we say, Noah, you can't pull your brother. You can't just rip him down off the monkey bars. That's dangerous. Why? What do you mean, why? You know, Noah, you can't tell your brother to grab a hot poker from the fire. Why? What do you mean, why? And so if you're a parent, you hear this question over and over and over, and it's often in quick succession, right? You'll tell them why, and then they'll say why to whatever you told them, and then you'll tell them that, and then they'll say why to whatever you told them about whatever you told them, and it goes like 5 levels deep. So what I've started doing is I start looping it around, right? This is genius. So I'll get like 3 levels deep. I realize it's not going to stop, and so I'll just answer with my first answer. And then after about 3 of those rounds, and they realize they're not getting anywhere. So anyways, you hear that over and over and over again. And if you're a parent, if the kid does whatever you've asked them to and then asks why, great, I'm happy to explain it. But if they just put their foot in the ground and they refuse to do what you're asking them to do and they say why, it's because really what they're saying is, I won't do this unless you give me a good reason to. I won't do this unless it is somehow beneficial to me, unless it makes sense to me. So are we in the same way? Are we treating Jesus as our Lord, even when it doesn't make sense? Or are we treating him as an advisor? Someone who gives us good advice that we can choose to take, or we can choose to leave based on if it's beneficial to us. And so I feel for Peter here. He is in a tough spot. He's thinking, I know fish. This is not how you fish. He's thinking, what if this doesn't work? There are potentially hundreds of people on the shore watching him right now. The fishermen. And I don't know if you know anything about Peter, but he's a little bit arrogant, right? And so now all of a sudden, he's about to do something that would be extremely embarrassing, might even destroy his reputation as a fisherman. And so he's, understandably so, he's asking, why? You're a carpenter. Why are you telling me to do this? And so I think there's a little bit of a deeper level, though, here as well. So a guy named Michael Wilcock, he says this. He says, as long as Simon's boat is being used for a pulpit, the owner has no objection to Jesus saying in it what he likes. But when it reverts to being a fishing boat, it's Simon's once more, and Jesus should no longer have a say in how it is to be used. I think in the same way, we can easily tend to compartmentalize our relationship with Jesus. And so the way that I like to think about this is a lot like apps on your phone, right? A lot of you have a phone. Go ahead and hold up a phone if you have one there. There you go. And so on your phone, if you have a smartphone that's been made within the last decade or so, then you probably have apps on it, right? And so the different apps, you pull up your phone and then you can pull up the Messages app there, or you can pull up your email app, you can do all these different things. But then when it's time to go and do a different app, you close the app that you were previously in. So here's an app. And you close that one and then you go into this app over here, that app over there to try to do something. And so oftentimes we want to treat Jesus like an app. We pull him up on Sunday mornings. We pull him up for some devotional time early in the morning. We pull him up right before dinner so that we can pray. But then when it's time to move on to something else, we close that app and we open up the other app. We open up work, or we open up family, or we open up leisure time, or we open up our love life, whatever it may be. But Jesus, he's not just an app on our phone that we can open up and then close when it's time to shift to something else. Jesus is more like the firmware. He's the operating system. He's the framework by which all other apps operate. And that's how we have to treat him. He's the one that pervades into every category of our life. And so when we open up the app of work, when we open up the app of our phone time, when we open up the app of entertainment, it's through the framework of our relationship to Christ, of the fact that we are following Jesus. And that's what you see over and over again in this passage. And so look at Peter's response here, and this is amazing. Despite everything saying none of this makes sense, but at your word, I will let down the nets. But even though I don't get it, at your word, I will let down the nets. Sometimes faith is obeying even when it doesn't make sense. Sometimes faith is saying yes, even when you don't have the enthusiasm to do so. Even when you can't possibly see why this would be a good route to take, why this would be a wise choice, why this would be something that the Lord would command, say yes. And that's what Peter did here, even though it didn't make any sense to him. And then look at the result that he gets. Number two, the catch. It says, when they had done this, when Peter had said yes, it says they enclosed a large number of fish and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both of the boats so that they began to sink. And this will be a short point here, but I think that this really shows the authority of Jesus. It shows the sovereignty of Jesus. The same God that appoints the fish to jump in the net is the same God that appointed the fish to swallow Jonah. It says in Jonah, the end of chapter 1. It's the same God that appointed the locusts and the frogs in Egypt. It's the same God that appointed the fish later to get a coin in its mouth that the disciples get so that they can buy some food or pay tax, or I don't remember why they needed money. It's the same God that appoints the ravens to come feed Elijah when there's a drought. That's the same God that appoints these fish here. And to one level deeper here, the same Jesus that caused the fish to jump in the boat in the morning is the same Jesus that caused the fish to hold off the night before. So sometimes Jesus might be withholding something from you during the night so that you can be blessed in the morning. And so the same God causes both, and so we know that we can trust him. And so, and he often does it like he did with Peter in such a way that we know it's from him. We know it's, there was no question that this was from Jesus. It didn't make any sense for a professional fisherman to fail so miserably and then succeed so wildly using techniques that nobody had ever heard of. And yet it happened because it's God. And no one can question that it's God. All right, so number three, the confession. So what was Peter's response, right? If it were me, and if I just laid down the Bible and I read the first part of this book and it said, and then all these fish, most amazing thing, fishing all night, nothing, and then incredible, what would you assume Peter's response would be? I think I would assume that his response would be, did you see that? Look at all these fish. This is crazy. I'm going to be rich. I could take these to the market. I'm set up for months. Did anybody get this on video? Seriously, if you post this on your store, you better tag me, because I'm the one who said yes, and I'm the one who got all the fish that sank both boats, right? Get a picture of Jesus and I. Get a picture. No, get both boats. Get both boats. Yeah, here we go. Get both boats. There it is. That might be the response, but that's not how Peter responded. Instead, it almost seems like he responded completely opposite to that. Instead, he said this. It says, when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man. See, Peter, he was not looking at the blessing. He was looking at Jesus. He wasn't looking at the things that he just caught in his net. He wasn't looking at the success that God just gave him. He was looking at God himself. And he was seeing this miracle as something that told him about who Jesus was, not just about what Jesus could do for him. And so that's what brought about this response. It's God manifesting himself through this miracle, manifesting his glory. In other words, this passage is not about the fish. This passage is not about what was in the net. This passage is about Jesus. And so this happens right in front of him, and it's completely and totally overwhelming to Peter. In fact, it's so overwhelming. Notice how Jesus responds to him. He has to say, "Fear not. Fear not." Because Peter was terrified. Peter was scared, so Jesus has to encourage him by saying, "Fear not." Now, this, what Peter's doing right here, this is the right human response to seeing God's glory, to seeing who God really is. And you see this all throughout the Bible. There's an author in the early 20th century, a guy by the name of Rudolf Otto, and he wrote a book in the 30s, I think, all about the holiness of God. And so, anyways, he talks about the holiness of God, the glory of God, and religious experience and these different things, writing from a mostly Christian perspective. And what he said is this. He said that when you see God's glory, when you see the glory of the divine, he says it is, on the one hand, incredibly attractive. And on the other hand, he says, it's repulsive. He says it undoes you. There's a pull and there's a push at the same time that you see. So when you see God's glory, you want to at the same time be in it. You want to be a part of it. You want to experience it. And you see how unglorious you really are in comparison. And so you see the beauty, but you see the gap at the same time. And so you realize that you want to be like him, but you also realize that you're not like him. And so let's look at this at a couple places in the Bible. Moses, he was the one who went up on the mountain. He said, "God, show me your glory." And God said, "If I show you my glory, you'll die." And so he took him, faced him backwards, put him inside the crest of a rock, the fold of a rock, and covered him over. And then Moses got like the backwards, upside down, passing reflection of God's glory, right? And it was so much that when he walked down off the mountain, his face was glowing with the glory of God. And guess what it did? It terrified everybody else who saw it. They said, "Cover it up! We don't want to see that! Put a veil over that thing!" And so he's attracted to it. He says, "Show me your glory." But it's so much that it scares people and would have killed Moses if he saw it fully. So Job, he says, right, the story of Job in Job 42, he says this after God finally shows up to Job and speaks to him. And Job says, "My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, because my eyes have seen you, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." And then God ends up lifting him up in the end. Or the passage in Isaiah chapter 6, it says, in the year King Uzziah died, Isaiah, he saw the Lord high and lifted up. And then after this magnificent vision, he says this. He says, "Woe to me," I cried. This is Isaiah speaking. He says, "I am ruined." Another translation says, "I'm undone. I'm psychologically being ripped apart. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. My eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." So God's glory in its purest form is on one hand beautiful, compelling, attractive, fascinating, pulling. And on the other hand, it's overwhelming. It's terrifying. It's shrinking. On one hand, threatens you, but on the other hand, you want nothing more than to be a part of it. And so we see this very briefly on a human level every once in a while, right? And so think about, you're at a dinner party, and just think about the thing that you're really good at. Whatever it is that you just sort of take pride in, right? And you're at the dinner party, and you're telling, not that you would do this, but you're at the dinner party, and you're telling just a big group of people about how really good you are at this thing, right? And then imagine that somebody in that same field, but far, far, far better than you, at the top of the field, all of a sudden shows up to that dinner party and says, "Hey, what are you talking about?" So imagine if you pride yourself in business, right? And you're talking about how good of a businessman you are. And let's say Warren Buffett comes in and he says, "Hey, what are you talking about over there?" Nothing at all. Or let's say that you're really good at basketball, right? And you're good at shooting hoops. And so you're telling all your friends about how you sank this three, right? Like a fading three. It was just so sick. And then all of a sudden you bump into somebody and it's LeBron James behind you. And he goes, "Hey, I wanted to hear that story. What are you saying?" "Oh, nothing. Don't even worry about it," right? And so at the one hand, you would be humbled. But on the other hand, you wouldn't want to leave necessarily. Because somebody is in the room that excels at the thing that you take pride in, right? And so you would want to talk to them. You would want to be a part of that. And so that's just a small fraction. Now imagine that you are anywhere and God shows up in the room. The one who laid the foundations of the earth. The one who put up the boundary for the Sea of Galilee where they're fishing. The one who hangs the stars in the sky. When he shows up, we're humbled. But at the same time, we want nothing more than to be a part of that beauty. So that's what Peter is experiencing here. And so Jesus, he looks at him, and look at the grace that Jesus has. He looks at him and he says, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." So Jesus, he puts all of his fears at rest. Jesus, he didn't come to judge Peter. Jesus came to call Peter. I want to turn your attention towards a parallel passage. And by parallel, I mean it's a similar account, but that happened at a different time. So this is right at the outset. Luke 5 is right at the outset of Jesus' ministry. This is right at the end of Jesus' ministry. It's in John chapter 21. And this is what happened. So right after death of Jesus, ministry of Jesus, Peter denies him 3 times. Jesus rises again. And this is right before he's about to reinstate Peter. And this is what he says. He says, "After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas Nathanael, the sons of Zebedee, and 2 others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, 'I'm going fishing.' They said, 'We'll go with you.' But they went out, got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, 'Children, do you have any fish?' They answered him, 'No.' He said to them, 'Cast the net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some.' So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of the fish. The disciple whom Jesus loved therefore said to Peter, 'It is the Lord.' And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. When they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. And Jesus said to them, 'Bring some of the fish that you've just caught.' And he has breakfast with them." So do you see the similarities there? Same problem, no fish all night. Same solution, miraculous catch of way too much fish to fit in the boat. But look at Peter's response. Do you see how different it is? The first time, the Luke 5 Peter says, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man. You have no idea what I've done." The post-resurrection Peter leaps out of the boat just so he can be with Jesus. That's what God's grace does to us. We need to recognize the gap. We need to recognize that we are not worthy to be in the presence of Jesus. But we need to recognize that because of the cross and the resurrection, we now can jump out of the boat. When we sin, when we deny him, we can run towards him because of his grace. In John 21, Peter was much more aware of his sin than he was in Luke 5. You could say he sinned worse by the time we get to John 21. He denied the Son of God on the eve of his death 3 times like a coward and then ran into the night weeping. And yet he runs to him. That's his grace. See, Peter, he recognizes. He recognizes that Jesus, there's no reason why Jesus would stay with him. There's no reason why Jesus would ask him to follow him, why Peter shouldn't just depart. But at the same time, he recognizes that Jesus, he died on the cross. And on the cross, he cried out, my God, why have you departed from me? Why have you forsaken me?" The Father departed from the Son so that we will never have to depart from Jesus. We can run to him instead. That's what God's grace does. And now Jesus comes to Peter and he comes to all of us and he's able to say, "Fear not, fear not." As we begin to close here, I'll close with the calling. So after this, he says, "Do not be afraid, Peter." He says, "From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. This is where it all comes together. So Jesus has been preaching the word of God. And one way to look at this is Jesus has been casting the net of truth over the crowd. And then he performs this miraculous catch of fish, and then he uses it as an analogy to say, Peter, this is what I'm calling you to. I'm calling you to be a fisherman, not of fish, but of people. I'm calling you to catch people for the kingdom, not to death, but unto life. And so he uses the entire miracle as an analogy for what he's calling Peter to, because it's not about the fish. And look at the way Jesus does this. He says, Peter, from now on, from now on, from now on, it doesn't matter what your past has looked like, because from now on, this is what I'm calling you to. And if you follow the book of Luke, amazingly, before this encounter, Peter is only known as Simon. He's only known as Simon. And then only in this passage, only in Luke 5, does he get the name Simon Peter. And then after Luke 5, he is only ever called Peter, the name that Jesus gave him. This was a life-transforming moment for Peter. This is what transitioned him from Simon to Peter. And so I don't know where you're at tonight, but maybe this is a from now on kind of night for you. Maybe this is a from now on, I will follow Jesus. From now on, I won't close the app quite as much. I'll keep it open. From now on. And so, and then of course, Peter, it says, they left everything. And I'll invite the worship team up at this point to play our closing song. It says they left everything. And this is what's amazing here. Did you see what they left? Everything. Do you know what that means, they left? They left the catch of fish. Peter left the fish. This miraculous catch that Jesus performed this miracle for, Peter left it. The most successful business venture that Peter had ever seen, he left behind so that he could follow Jesus. Right? It'd be really easy. Sort of the prosperity preaching way to preach this would be just obey Jesus and he'll bless your business. Obey Jesus and he'll bring in the fish for you. But that would completely miss the point of the passage, because Peter left the fish to follow him, to follow Jesus. He left everything. And so Jesus, he might not be calling you into a vocational ministry tonight, but he is calling you to follow him. And so when you go back to work on Monday, when you go back to the office, when you go back to the job site, maybe you're working at home, when you go back to the computer, whatever it is that you do, do it while you're following Jesus. Do it while you're following him and while you're making him known, while you're catching men, while you're catching women, while you're catching people to be a part of his kingdom. That's what he's calling us to do. Bow your heads and pray with me. Father, we thank you that you are still catching people, Lord. That you are still drawing people to yourself, and you call us not to force the fish into the net. God, you just call us to lay the net down. And so I pray we would do that, Lord. Whatever that looks like in our work, whatever that looks like in our home, let us lay the net down so that more and more people would follow you. God, thank you that you caught us. Thank you that you brought us to yourself. And thank you that you empower us through the death and resurrection of Jesus, through your grace, to follow you, Lord. God, you don't depart from us. You don't leave us. You never forsake us, Lord. Instead, you're with us. And so we praise you for that tonight, and we love you. Amen. Go ahead and stand with me as we sing this last song.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God at the name it is the
As you go, I want to send you out with this blessing so that you can go out and catch people, and glorify God, and follow Him in every sphere of your life. The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. Amen. God be with you. We'll see you next week.